The big news is this. Our city is coming back. We are rebounding in an extraordinary way. We're going to make sure that we're taking down the boards, flinging open the doors, and reopening our city. A big part of that is making sure that we're getting the necessary money and resources to those that need it most, to those businesses who need that urgent kind of support, to those workers who have been working so hard over this last year, putting themselves and their own health on the line to get our city through the most difficult time in history. And right now, we've got an opportunity. We've got an opportunity because we've had $270 million coming in through the American Rescue Act, $89 million of which we're going to be able to allocate in the immediacy to people, to businesses, to workers who need it most. This money is fashioned to reignite our city. This money is fashioned to bring us back in an extraordinary way, and the people who are here with me, they've been making it all happen. Right now, you probably know we are in Wendy's House of Soul. Wendy's has been one of the 1,700 entities, restaurants, bars, breweries, distilleries, and coffee shops that have been pushing forward each and every day over this last year to make sure that through some of the most difficult of circumstances, our city continues to truck. I want to send my full appreciation to them and all of the work that they've been doing over that period of time. Also want to give a big thank you to the Minneapolis Forward Community Now Coalition. Back when COVID and this pandemic first hit, they recognized that we were going to need to do things differently. They recognized that economic inclusion was going to need to be the foundational pillar in each and everything that we did, and that means that our BIPOC community, our BIPOC leaders, are not just key decision makers at the table, but that our BIPOC community were key recipients of the benefit of the work. And so that's how we've been operating over this last year. And this Minneapolis Forward Community Now Coalition, led by one of the co-chairs that's here with me, and Kenya McKnight Ahad, as well as Sean Pierce, who's on my staff operating in a way as an ED, they've moved forward and given a series of really important recommendations. Those recommendations, we're not just taking as input, we are actually carrying out. And so some of these proposals that we're moving forward right now, they have come from community, and it is also for community. And so that's the shift and the transformational thought as to how we've been thinking about this. Again, it's $37 million in total that we're going to be focusing towards this really important economic inclusion activity, and I'm going to give you a rundown of each one of those segments. So first, the Minneapolis Forward Community Now Coalition felt strongly that we needed to have monies so that we wouldn't just have black business owners, but that those black business owners could own the property on which the building sits. And this is really important because time and again, we've seen these extraordinary black-owned businesses that have gotten themselves set up, have attracted an extraordinary clientele and customer base, and because of their great work, the values of the property rise. The rents get jacked through the roof, and the people that have made these neighborhoods wonderful to begin with get the boot through displacement. So through this Commercial Property Development Fund and the $10 million that we're allocating here, we can make sure that these same communities are benefiting from the valuation increase. They are benefiting from the improvements that they themselves have poured their blood, sweat, and tears into. That's $10 million into the Commercial Property Development Fund. Another $17 million on top of that is devoted to direct business and worker assistance. These are monies to eliminate the fees that they would otherwise have to pay from March to December. This is making sure that we're helping to pay down some of the loans that they already have. This is making sure that some of the businesses that have shut and closed their doors over this last year have the ability to reopen and reopen quickly to benefit from some of this pent-up demand that we're inevitably going to see. There's a lot of people right now that are going to want to buy soul rolls. There's a lot of people that are going to want to experience community again in this extraordinary setting. We need to make sure that businesses and workers throughout the city have that ability to do so. We also know that 1 in 4 Minneapolis residents have filed for unemployment. So we need to make sure that we've got a workforce development program that's up and running to get people back to work, to place them in these jobs where we know there's going to be a heap ton of demand. Part of making sure that they're getting back in these jobs to begin with is making sure that they are connected to where those jobs are. And so we've got an additional program, which is an ambassador one, to make sure that those community connections are bridged right from the get-go. But we didn't stop there. We wanted to have monies in cultural districts as well. We've got about 6 cultural districts throughout the city. These are areas where our communities of color, our immigrant communities, have stepped up in a beautiful way to make these communities home, to set up businesses. We want to make sure that these areas are revitalized. Sadly but truly, a lot of the areas that were hit worst by the pandemic are the same businesses and the same corridors that were hit most by the unrest following the murder of George Floyd. This is the kind of assistance that they need right now for everything from, you know, safety to lighting improvements to cleaning up the sidewalk to make sure that we've got people that are doing that necessary outreach again to get these corridors bolstered and reopening again. This has been pretty widely covered. We've also got a guaranteed basic income program as well, which is in pilot form right now. It's $3 million, I believe, in total, going to help about 200 different families in $500 payments per month. We know that families are best situated to be able to determine how to spend their limited cash, and whether that's daycare or fixing the car or paying for rent. This money will help them get the flexibility that they need, and I'll note, importantly, a lot of these monies can, in addition to other areas, go to that very important intersection of 38th and Chicago, where this 100 years in the making reckoning around racial justice has gotten started in big form. So, you know, this is important monies and important relief that is going to community at a very critical time. And we've got the right partners right here who are on the ground who are about to speak to all of these facets that will be able to give the rundown of how we the city are working with them and the work that they've done to make sure that our economy is coming back. So again, big thank you to Wendy's House of Soul here, all the work that they've done. And specifically right now, I'm going to have Heather Warfield come up, who has been doing some extraordinary work right here in this spot in North Minneapolis. So thank you so much for your work. Proud to have you up to the microphone. Okay. Well, tell us about your business. Give us the rundown of the work that you're doing right here.
Okay, so I'm Heather Warfield with Wendy's House of Soul. I handle the catering and the business aspect of the business. What we're doing, or what we've been doing, is we fortunately have been able to remain open during the unrest, during the pandemic. The challenges that we've seen are, of course, the violence within our community, the price increases, different fees we have to pay. But with what we've been told is about to hopefully happen within our city is we're going to get assistance with that. Again, we've been very fortunate. We've been able to keep our doors open, keep all of our staff. Our catering is back, increasing. So we brought some more staff back on. That's it?
No, you nailed it. I caught her off guard for a minute there.
Can we get her name and correct spelling? So, because they're logging.
Yeah, sure.
Heather Warfield, it's H-E-A-T-H-E-R. Warfield is W-A-R-F-I-E-L-D.
Thank you, Mayor.
Great. Next, we've got Kenya McKnight Ahad, who is the head of the Black Women's Wealth Alliance, but also has been the co-chair of the Minneapolis Forward Community Now Coalition over this past year. Really appreciate all of the work that she has done.
Does this matter?
Okay.
Okay. There's a twisty nod there.
We're good. If you can hear me,
yeah, we can hear you.
We're good. Okay. So, Kenya McKnight-Ahad, president and founder of the Black Women's Wealth Alliance. We are a North Minneapolis-born business that serves Black women in the space of cultural wellness. We provide cultural wellness education, business technical support services, and direct financial assistance to Black women entrepreneurs, as well as workers. And to date, we've served over 4,000 Black women, entrepreneurs and workers across the state, and more in the city, and more likely in North Minneapolis. And some of our work happens through our partnership with CPED, who provides us with support to provide technical assistance. what I want to speak to you about today, and also want to just say that I am an influential member of the Minneapolis Coalition, Now Forward Coalition, Allison Sharkey and Felicia Perry. Allison Sharkey of the Lake Street Council and Felicia Perry of the West Broward Area and Business Coalition are the co-chairs, but I am influential. It's okay. So I'm like a third co-chair, if you will. But we really appreciate all of the work that this coalition has done to help push our city forward at a really deep and dark time. We got together last year to really push on this economic recovery and the sort of an impact it has to have on Black, Brown, and Indigenous communities and immigrant communities across our city. So in that, we're still doing a lot of work. And what you're hearing today is just the starting place. It isn't the end of it. It's a starting place that we're really proud of. And we appreciate the mayor taking our recommendations and his staff very seriously to really make that commitment to push our city forward despite the challenges we're facing. In my work, I am also proud to announce today that I received final approval from the city of Minneapolis for the Community Development Fund of $500 million to purchase the 1200 West Broadway property. So I am an example of this very Black entrepreneur purchasing commercial space in North Minneapolis, a place that I've grown up for 35 years of my life. And that's just a starting place too. We are very happy that this fund will see $10 million to support more Black and other Indigenous, immigrant, BIPOC entrepreneurs across our city. That is the pillar to wealth building is ownership. And we need to make sure we increase that. And lastly, the Ambassadors Program to help increase workforce opportunity through training and education, skill building, as well as relationship building throughout our city, with a hyper focus on what's happening in South Minneapolis. As we know, the pandemic impacted all of our communities and impacted the BIPOC community, and specifically Black, in a way that is going to take Black folks a much longer to recover from the business, workforce, household crises that we're facing. So in my closing, I want to just remind you that this is just a really important starting place, and we have to keep pushing our economic recovery forward in our city, even in our darkest times. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kenya McKnight-Ahad, for all of the work that you're doing, and congratulations on the $500,000 that will be going towards the ownership itself. Next, we've got up Abe Dimash, who's been doing such an extraordinary job speaking out, making sure that we are recovering in extraordinary fashion. And, you know, this is a time when we actually get to talk about something positive that's happening in the city. And he's been part of this this community from day one. As you know, he's the GNL furniture owner. And let me invite up Abe to the microphone here. Thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting me all. I want to start in the name of God and merciful and compassionate. It's been a pleasure to be here in front of all of you guys today. Some of you may recognize me from GNL Furniture, also from Southside and commercial developer. I have been a resident and business owner in the city of Minneapolis for the last 30 years. In my years, I have had several support from the immigrants community and the African American communities in Minneapolis who have been my most loyal customers. Being in business here over the few years, I've had a pleasure to learn about the difference culture that makes a city great. All the diverse communities that coexist to bring fresh perspective to our lives and help us open minds, empathize with one another. The city has passed many tests and grown stronger that was test harder than we faced in the past year. We were faced with unprecedented pandemic that turned our lives and business upside down. What shortly followed was the tragic murder of George Floyd and the civil unrest uprising that has caused. It has shown me the city is the strongest when it comes together, that we should not be separate as a community of immigrants, African Americans, and Native Americans, but we should come together and make sure our voices are heard because of our support of our communities, to our businesses, and our community would not be able to achieve fullest potential. And I would also want to thank you, all of you guys, for attending today. And in closing, I want to say to all of you, with the help of God, as a mayor said, as Kenny McNair said, we're going to come back as the strongest as ever before. And I'm hoping that we're going to rebuild the city together. That's I've lost businesses in South Minneapolis. That did not turn me wrong. I came back very hard. And I would like to have everybody have to have a positive attitude. We'll, if we work all of us together, I think we'll come harder than ever before. Thank you all.
That deserves some applause. I couldn't have said it better myself. You know, the city is coming back in extraordinary fashion. It's because of people like you all. Yeah. Well, with that, we'll open it to questions about this topic. If out of respect for the business here and the people who agree with me, if you got a different topic, you know, let's hang tight for a second before we go outside.
What are the next steps then for you to push this proposal and get this money?
So, we've provided a recommendation as to how to spend the initial $89 million as part of the Rescue Act funding. There have and will be council presentations and public hearings associated with it. And then I believe on July 2nd, the City Council is primed to amend and then approve the final allocations. And, you know, the goal here is urgency. I mean, there is an urgency associated with this initial $89 million push. And so we want to get the funds out to people who need them as quickly as possible.
When could that be realistically?
So the question is, when could it be realistically? It depends on the category of funding. There's some funding that we're going to be able to get out like immediately after the approval. There's other funding that is going to require the formation of a program to get set up, so it might take a little bit longer. It depends.
Barriers when businesses try to access funding that has been allotted to them. One of the barriers is sometimes they get penalized if their business did better this year than it did in the 2019 that they are comparing the funds to. Are there any parameters about how to help businesses that have been affected without such strict guidelines holding them back because of
year prior? So it's a really great question. A lot of the parameters that I believe that you're referencing in terms of support are set up through either the state or the federal level. So while I can't speak to that, our goal as a city is to get this money as quickly as possible, first to those that need it most. And whether that's around businesses that closed through the pandemic, getting them to quickly be able to open, or that's setting these liaisons up front that can do the necessary outreach to figure out what your specific business needs, and then we can best determine how to help. We can't put every single business into the same category because they've had drastically different experiences over this last year, and that's why we need to be providing the sensitivity of care and the specificity of need for each one of these individual entities.
So do the businesses receive this as an additional funding that'll come if they've already received any funding or allotted hours that they get through the city? Does this additional or is this an exclusive?
This is additional monies.
Okay.
Yeah.
How many businesses, do you have a ballpark, how many will be helped by this? I mean, have they been identified? Or are you reaching to them, or are they coming to you?
I mean, for starters...
Sorry, I'm blocking a shot.
for starters, most every business in the city that signs up for licenses or fees associated with their industry, they'll get a break right away, and that's from March to December. And so that is a wide swath. In addition to that wide swath, we also have some really specific and intentional allocations that are made, for instance, along cultural corridors and districts, to in some of the ACP 50 areas that we see, and also businesses, for instance, that have closed but are planning to reopen. And so we've been both broad scale but also really strategic as to how we get the monies out.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Thank you so much,
everyone. Thank you.
I have an unrelated question, sort of related, but it's the legislature, potential to bond and build for some relief to the businesses on Lake Street and others affected by the unrest. What are your hopes there? What are you looking for?
So I've got a missed call and a text message that I just got from Commissioner Steve Groh literally minutes ago. And so I want to make sure that I have a conversation with him about the strategy moving forward here first. But here's the real answer. I mean, This money here is COVID related. This is recovering from the COVID pandemic and economic downturn there. We also need assistance from, in terms of the fact that we had a number of these entities that were severely hit by the unrest following the killing of George Floyd. That is monies that we're hoping to get, and assistance that we're hoping to receive through the state. And I'll note that for every dollar that the city of Minneapolis generates for taxation purposes, we get about 30 cents back. So we put in $1, the city of Minneapolis gets 30 cents back in assistance. And we're proud to be the economic generator of our entire state. We're proud that we're able to assist counties and smaller towns throughout the state of Minnesota. But when we need help, as the city of Minneapolis, yeah, absolutely. We're calling on the legislature. We're calling on the state to make sure that Minneapolis also gets its fair share and necessary resources.
There's a number of businesses there that are waiting now over a year. That's got to be frustrating.
Of course. I mean, it's frustrating for me. It's more frustrating for those business owners that have been in this position for a long time. So, I mean, I'd talk directly to them, and they'll tell you about how much this funding has been needed and over how long, and the trials and tribulations that they've been through over this last year. Now's the time. Now's the time.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much. That's good stuff.
And hopefully you'll push the state to the size of the way you're saying the shot.